I'm in the library of the Monell Chemical Senses Center with Dr. Charles Wysocki. Your position is now emeritus?
Correct.
Okay. And you've been working at Monell for how long?
I came to Monell in August of 1978.
Okay. And where were you before then? What brought you to Monell?
I was doing dissertation research in graduate school at Florida State University in Tallahassee.
So there's a lot of small research happening in Florida State to this day, right?
FSU. Yes, yes, there is.
And what is it that you were doing there?
My research involved looking at inbred strains of mice. Inbred strains are all genetically identical within a strain. And I was looking across different inbred strains of mice to determine whether any of those inbred strains were insensitive to specific odorants for which humans also show a deficit. Notable among them at the time when I was working was a compound called isovaleric acid. It's a pretty nasty smell, as you know. You've used it.
We are currently using isovaleric acid. And it smells like vomit.
Yes.
Okay.
And there are people who cannot smell it, even at very strong concentrations. And so we decided to see whether we could find some mice that also showed this deficit. And the reason being, there are things that you really can't do with humans.
Ethically.
And technically, for that matter.
Okay.
But with an animal model, there's a lot of leeway to explore avenues for research. And we wanted to determine whether we could find an animal model that was analogous to what we see in humans.
And so would this fall under the umbrella of like specific anosmias?
Exactly.
Okay. And just lay that out, unpack that for people who might be watching this that don't know what those words mean.
Specific anosmia is an inability to smell a specific compound or a small set of compounds that are related. Although your general sense of smell is fully functional. That's a distinction that's made because there's another syndrome called anosmia, which is an inability to smell anything.
Mm-hmm. Now, I'm familiar with specific anosmias. I didn't realize, so you're saying that isovaleric acid is one of the odors that humans have specific anosmias to?
Yes.
And is a specific anosmia to. So others might be what else? What are some other benchmarks?
There's a compound that's called androstenone. Androstenone is a steroid, and about 45 to 50% of people cannot smell that. Of the remaining, some people, about 35% of people, smell it and are very, very sensitive to it. And to them, it smells stale urine. The other remaining percentage of people who can smell it report various descriptors. Some call it floral, some call it sweet, some call it woody. They're much less sensitive to the compound than the urinous group. But they can still smell it.
The stale urine, as compared to the fresh urinous groups.
Yes. There are many other compounds that also exhibit specific anosmia. Notable among them is one that's found in human underarm sweat. It's 3-methyl-2-hexanoic acid. About 15% of people cannot smell that. There's another compound that's often found in municipal water, especially during the summertime, and especially if the water is drawn from, let's say, a major river. It results from algal blooms in the water, and it's very difficult to eliminate in the cleaning process. It's called geosmin. It has a very earthy smell. About 12 to 15% of people cannot smell that odor.
So you were we're talking about specific anosmias specifically because you were looking at genetically similar mice that were having specific anosmias similar to humans. That's what you were doing at Florida State?
That's correct.
Okay.
And what's interesting about that is when I presented the work, actually it was in my master's thesis, I had a defense for that. One of my committee members said, Mr. Wysocki, You've been talking all along as if this is through olfaction, the sense of smell.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you know it's not from the vomeronasal organ? The committee member was Dr. Don Tucker.
Okay.
Dr. Tucker slammed his hand on the table and said, "Mr. Wysocki, you don't know what the vomeronasal organ is?" "No, I don't, Dr. Tucker." I said, "You have 1 week. I want to see you in my office, and you're going to give me a full report about what the vomeronasal organ is." I spent the next week in the library, whenever the library was open and wherever I had free time.
And so if you were to bumper sticker right now what the VNO is...
The vomeronasal organ, or the VNO, is primarily involved, but not always, primarily involved in the perception of pheromones.
In mammals?
In mammals, although there is an analogous structure that's also found in non-mammalian life forms.
Okay.
And there may, in fact, be... not a separate organ itself, but a separate epithelium. That's what we call the sensory part of these structures, both the sense of smell and the sense through the vomeronasal organ.
Okay.
There may be epithelial structures that are analogous that are found in cartilaginous fish.
Okay. So you spent a week studying the VNO. You went back to Dr. Tucker's office, and you presented him everything you knew.
Exactly right.
Okay.
And I wound up publishing a review paper and also established a seminar series, a weekly seminar series for a semester.
On the VNO.
On the vomeronasal system found in amphibians, fish, amphibians, reptiles, and mammals.
So you all of a sudden became an expert on the VNO.
I wrote a paper. Exactly. I wrote a paper. And of all the papers that I've published, I've published well over 125 papers. That is the most widely cited paper.
Well, it's the fact that it has to do with pheromones. And I do want you to finish the story about you coming to Monell. But obviously, there was a time when it was a very hot topic to talk about when trying to talk about human pheromones. And the fact that we have a VNO that is active in infancy, but through human development, it becomes unattached neurologically?
There is a vomeronasal structure in almost all adults as well.
Okay.
But it's devoid of sensory cells.
Okay.
Those sensory cells do exist neonatally. The epithelium, that sensory epithelium, degenerates at about 19 weeks of gestation. But importantly, while it's alive and developing neonatally, it is that nerve that connects from the nose to the brain that is also used as a ladder or a lattice by a special group of cells that have their origins in the nasal cavity. And those cells are called gonadotropin-releasing hormone cells, GnRH-containing cells. Now, GnRH is very important for sexual development. It's also important in adulthood to regulating the female menstrual cycle. And it also regulates testosterone in males. If that vomeronasal epithelium were absent, those GnRH-containing cells would not have a ladder or a lattice to make their migration from their location in the nose to the different parts in the primarily the basal forebrain and the hypothalamus.
So the way that you're talking about it, it's as though they serve a very specific function, and then once its utility is done, then it starts to degenerate. Like,
that's
job done here.
That's one interpretation. Yes.
Okay. So let's go back. So you talk to Don Tucker, you learn about the VNO, you stumble on being an expert on the VNO, and how does that lead towards you finishing your PhD thesis, dissertation, and eventually landing at Monell?
PhD dissertation was an extension of my master's thesis, which was the genetics involved in inbred strains of mice and their inability to smell specific compounds, specific anosmia. I completed that, but primarily because I also had an interest in chemical communication among mammals. I knew there was a researcher, Dr. Gary Beecham, who was at Monell and was conducting and publishing many papers on chemical communication. And his model system at the time was the guinea pig. So I came to Monell to interview, and I really liked what was going on at Monell at the time. They had a very strong program in chemical communication. Gary was one of the leaders in that program.
But, so before you go on, chemical communication, it makes sense to me, obviously, because I'm a little deeper in the research than maybe some of the people watching. So what is chemical communication?
Animals, including humans, give off specific odors. Those odors communicate information. And that information, at least in humans, may be processed at a subconscious level. Although we certainly know of situations where we may be in public transportation or in an elevator and someone very near to you physically has a very off-putting body odor.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very conscious experience.
Okay.
But on the flip side of that, you've also heard about chemical attraction, and it was love on first smell. That's very difficult to demonstrate.
But it has been studied.
It has been studied. It has, and there does appear to be some form of chemical communication that may be processed subconsciously. There is a study that came out of Monell from Dr. Lundstrom's laboratory, where he demonstrated when he put women in a functional MRI and was able to scan the brain, he was able to show different parts of the brain were active when they were presented one of three different odors. One was an off-the-shelf smell.
Mm-hmm.
Another one came from a strange male, one that the women didn't know. And the other...
Strange as in unfamiliar.
Unfamiliar.
Okay.
Correct. And the other odor that was presented was from a familiar, very familiar male. And he also had the women, as they were being scanned, tell the experimenter whether it was a body odor, yes or no, and they were almost always right in determining whether it was body odor or not body odor, off-the-shelf odor. And then they had to say, if it was body odor, whether it was from an unfamiliar male or a familiar male. The brain scans revealed that parts of the brain that process the smells were active for all three of those different samples. There's a different part of the brain that registers activity when the fight or flight reflex, so to speak,
sure,
is activated. The only time that was activated when the women were smelling odors from an unfamiliar male.
So could that be considered an amygdala reaction?
Yes.
So almost fear.
Vigilance, maybe?
Vigilance.
And what's interesting about that was the brain was never wrong, or very rarely wrong. But the intellectual response that the women gave, oftentimes, it didn't match up with the brain, with the amygdala.
Interesting. Interesting.
So we do have, even among humans, the ability to recognize information that's present in different smells. Now that recognition may be subconscious, it may be at the conscious level as well.
So, and this is all under, this is you explaining what chemical communication is, and the reason why we dug deeper into it is because you said that that's what you were interested in, that's what Dr. Beecham was interested at Monell, and even though he was using a guinea pig model, you thought that he was kicking out the jam, so to speak, and that's what brought you here to interview.
Yes, and I must have done something right because I was offered a position.
Excellent.
as a postdoc.
So were you a postdoc under Dr. Beecham?
I was.
Okay. I didn't know that. And so I'm gonna lay out my naivety, right? I always thought that you were always human psychology of olfaction. Like I thought that was mostly the thrust of your research program. So I find it surprising and interesting that you came into Monell doing much, and your master's and doctoral thesis or dissertations were on animal models.
Correct.
Okay.
And it remained that way for many years after I came to Monell, initially working with Dr. Beecham with guinea pig. And what I brought to it, my knowledge of the vomeronasal system. So we spent many experiments looking at the role that the vomeronasal system may play in chemical communication in guinea pigs.
Okay.
And we published some papers along the way on that. I completed my postdoctoral work with Gary, and then was offered a position as an assistant member. That's the starting level. That's equivalent to an assistant professor at a university. I accepted it and transitioned from guinea pigs to mice, again trying to resume my initial dissertation research in a quest to find other smells that do have specific anosmias in people that also may show considerable variation among inbred strains of mice. And this time I chose androstenone, that urinous smell to people.
Now, androstenone, is this the one that is extracted from pigs?
It was first discovered in pig as what was called boar taint. It's found in the male pig,
okay,
especially in saliva, and is used in chemical communication with sow.
Mm-hmm.
When a sow is in heat and she smells androstenone, then she will reflexively assume what's called the lordosis position, the mating stance.
Yeah. So you were talking about the history of androstenone, how it was discovered, how it is used in animal husbandry, I guess?
It didn't start out being used in animal husbandry. It started out as an off flavor. The research was done in England, where they don't castrate their boars. And people were complaining about the terrible smell when they were cooking the pork. And the researchers in the food laboratories started a program to identify what the off odors were. And there were two that they primarily discovered. One was androstenone,
mm-hmm,
and its relative alcohol, the androstenol, and also skatol.
Mm-hmm.
Skatol smells like feces.
Skate. Scat.
And so as the program developed in England, they realized that some people could not smell androstenone. This further expanded in many laboratories, and all laboratories that began looking at that question began to report that, yes, there are people who cannot smell androstenone.
Hmm.
So given the prevalence of the deficit in humans and our previous ability to find deficits in inbred strains of mice for isovaleric acid, we felt we might just find the same thing in inbred strains of mice for androstenone. Mm-hmm. And we did.
And so that became your research program when you accepted a position as associate member?
No, that was when I accepted it as an assistant member.
Assistant member, I got that wrong. Okay.
And that continued into my appointment, my promotion to associate member. And it was about that time when I started expanding my research in and involving humans. At the time I had an NIH-supported grant to do my inbred strains of mouse research.
Mm-hmm.
And when I renewed that, I expanded that to include research using people and looking at different specific anosmias in people and possible influences of development, influences of gender, influences of aging.
So can you unpack that a little bit more? So what did you find when you were looking at genetically similar mice on their specific anosmia to androstenone, and how did that morph into being more interested in testing humans on the question of specific anosmia?
That's pushing back decades.
As you remember it, to the best of your recollection.
Well, the reason we chose androstenone to look at was its prevalence in humans, and there were all sorts of questions that needed to be asked. One of them was an interesting observation that I noticed when we were working with the inbred strains of mice, trying to screen many different strains. I initially could not smell androstenone. I was tested at Sloan Kettering in New York City by a very well-known researcher of human olfaction named John Amore. He since has passed on, but he determined that I could not smell androstenone. We were making smell test kits at Sloan Kettering to determine whether the genes that they were working with, those primarily involved with the immune system, whether those genes were also involved with specific anosmias or smell sensitivities.
Mm-hmm.
And we were developing these dual test kits. Androstenone was one of the samples that was included in the,
okay.
was going to be included in the test kit. And because I couldn't smell the androstenone, and everybody else could, and they all said it was urinous.
Did you make it super concentrated because you couldn't smell it? Was it blowing everyone else's mind?
Yes, and I was given the assignment to make the androstenone component of the smell kit because I couldn't smell it.
So you were perfect for it because you couldn't smell how gross it was.
Yes, exactly.
that's a very efficient, you know.
And when I returned from Sloan Kettering, I told, at that time, my boss, who was Gary Beecham, I was still a postdoc at the time. In fact, it was the first week I came to Monell, I was sent to New York City to do this. I told him about my inability to smell androstenone, and, okay, fine. After I finished my postdoc and when I started my own research program looking at different strains of mice, and we focused on androstenone as one of the components, I realized that over the time that I was doing the testing, I became sensitized. I was able to pick out which of the samples that I was making up. Some of them were blanks, some of them were the androstenone samples. I could tell which ones were the androstenone.
So what was that like? Was it just one day you were like, wow, I can tell the difference? Yeah. Or was it like it more gradual?
It took time.
Mm-hmm.
So I probably was noticing it at a subconscious level, but at one point, at a certain point, I said, wait a minute, I can smell this.
And what did it smell like? Qualitatively, what was that smell like to you?
Woody.
Okay. So you were the middle group. You weren't super sensitive to it. Okay.
I was not. And so at some point along the way, I got NIH funding to pursue this research, which included hiring a technician. As it turns out, the technician could not smell androstenone initially.
Mm-hmm.
But the more he worked with it over months, he became sensitized to it. This happened to another technician as well.
So now you have a bit of a pattern of behavior, of sensitization, or the ability.
There were now three in my laboratory who became sensitized to androstenone by repeated exposure over weeks. We put in a grant proposal. This time it was developed jointly with Gary and myself. And at that time, they used to have site visits where a team signed by NIH would come, in this instance, to Monell and interview us and listen to presentations. And when it came time for us to present our component of it, because this was a subcomponent of a larger grant that many investigators submitted to the NIH.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, we were laughed off the stage. They didn't believe us.
Oh, really?
So we were able, on our own, I forgot how we generated the funds to pay for subjects, but we did solicit subjects after, of course, getting the IRB approval to do the research.
Mm.
That's the Institution Review Board.
Yes.
So we were able to get a fairly inadequate sample of people who were non-smellers. Okay. Of androstenone.
So that's your inclusion criteria. You screened them for sensitivity to androstenone, and these were non-smell. These were specific people who had a specific anosmia, apparently, to androstenone.
Yes.
Okay.
So half of them, and we had a control odorant as well, and they all smelled it.
Hmm. And the purpose of that was to make sure that they weren't just straight up anosmic.
Correct.
Because if they were completely anosmic, then...
Correct.
Yeah, that would have confounded your results.
Yes.
Okay.
So what we then did was to split those people who had specific anosmia to androstenone into two groups. One group, they would not smell androstenone again until the end of the experiment, mm-hmm. 6 weeks.
Okay.
But they did smell the control odor.
Over the six weeks, okay.
Three times a day. The other group was assigned to smell the androstenone three times a day, morning, afternoon, evening, every day for 6 weeks. By about 4 weeks, about half of those people that were insensitive to androstenone started to show. And they also came in once a week and were tested, threshold tested. How low can you go in sensitivity?
Sure.
Initially, they couldn't detect even the highest concentration.
Mm-hmm.
But by about 4 weeks, we started to see a dip in the curve.
You could capture their threshold, right? Instead of them topping out, meaning they couldn't detect the most concentrated stimulus, now you're actually able to capture it, which means that they're detecting it at some level.
Yes, okay. Exactly. And those individuals who began to show a decline, or I should say an increase in sensitivity, showed further increases over the next couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So we captured in this experiment what three people in my laboratory experienced, sensitization mm-hmm. to androstenone.
Now you mentioned, that's what I was just going to point out. So of the people that were in the smell the androstenone three times a day for 6 weeks group, half of them sensitized.
Correct.
Okay.
And some of the people who entered into that experiment were employees of Monell. Fortunately, they were long-term employees of Monell because a year after they were sensitized, we tested them again, and they remained sensitive, as I have remained sensitive over the decades.
Even though you don't work with it all the time. So it's like a switch that got flipped.
Yes.
And once it's on, it's always on.
That's what it appears to be.
Okay. And so that's the work that you were doing when as an associate member.
It may have even continued into work as a member, a full member.
Okay.
So it was a long-term program.
Mm-hmm.
But that it basically got me started in my research with human olfaction. And it expanded in the 1980s when I teamed up with Dr. George Preti, also of Monell here, who at that time was very much interested in human body odor. And he...
For the purpose of science.
Yes.
Because we both know George, and if George ever watches this, he knows that we're busting his chops, but...
Yes. Not only science, but for some clinical end purposes as well.
Yes.
Because there are people who do report having a strong body odor. There's a syndrome called trimethylaminuria, or fishy body odor.
Mm-hmm.
And George probably has the largest database in the world of chemistry database, as well as his nose smelling patients who come to him.
And now these are people that are objectively emitting an odor, as compared to people who think that they're emitting an odor and it can't be verified in any objective sense? Or is it a combination of the two?
He probably sees both types of individuals, but primarily he is able to detect at least some off-putting odor in many of those patients that come to him.
Mm-hmm. And the reason TMA, trimethylamine, smells is a protein that just smells like fish.
Yes.
Okay. So that's why it was labeled that, and that is the. And are they literally off-gassing that? Are they off-gassing TMA, or it just happens to smell fishy?
It's primarily trimethylaminuria.
Okay. And is it coming off of their skin exclusively, or is it breath?
It's primarily the breath. That's where he generally collects from, but it can also be found in other parts of the body.
Okay. And so you got connected with Dr. Preti, who was also interested in body odors. You were doing androstenone, specifically for the purposes of looking at specific anosmias. And so how did
sensitization.
And sensitization. Oh, that's right. And sensitization to it. Were you trying to just, even though you were working with androstenone, were you trying to unpack the phenomenon of sensitization to odors that you initially couldn't smell? Or was there something about androstenone, because it's involved in chemical communication, that you were trying to answer questions about chemical communication as part of your research program and looking at sensitization to things you couldn't smell? Does that question make sense, like the way I'm distinguishing it?
It makes sense. And the reason we focused on the androstenone was because of the high frequency of people who could not smell it.
Okay. So it's easier to recruit participants. In a sense.
Yes. Initially, it was thought that because androstenone can be found in the armpit, it was thought, and because It is a pheromone in pigs. It was thought that perhaps humans are also communicating with this pheromone that's found in pigs. And for a while, groups were postulating that androstenone was a human pheromone. I think there's pretty good evidence that androstenone is probably not a human pheromone, although it is found in the armpit. The primary odorant that's found in the armpit, however, is 3-methyl-2-hexanoic acid.
Mm-hmm.
That has a characteristic armpit odor. There are other odors as well that are found in there. But the 3M2H, 3-methyl-2-hexanoic acid, is the primary underarm smell. So with George, we published dozens of papers on human, primarily human body odor, mostly from the armpit. We've learned a lot, and we've published a lot. We know that females have a less intense and less unpleasant underarm odor than do males.
Okay.
We know that contrary to much folklore, the elderly have a less intense and less unpleasant body odor than do younger people. We've also learned along the way that there are ethnic or racial differences in body odor.
Now, is that from a genetic perspective, or is that from a cultural perspective? So obviously, the food that you eat is going to affect the way that you smell. And so different cultures using different spices can contribute to that. So is it beyond just the environmental component, or is it, you know, for people that just happen to be ethnically and racially different in the same environment, there are differences?
It's likely both of those causes.
Okay.
And we published a paper from George's lab, which demonstrated that there is a particular gene that has been isolated that contributes to the look, feel, and smell of earwax.
Mm-hmm.
And for example,
it just sounds funny. Yeah, but even though I know that George does this, but it's just to hear it in a sentence, it's chuckle-worthy.
Well, we know that East Asian population has a particular, primarily have a particular gene that renders their earwax white and flaky and with little odor, whereas African Americans and whites have an intact gene that renders the earwax primarily brown and waxy, and it has a distinct smell.
Mm-hmm. So all of these differences, differences in gender, differences in age, difference in ethnicity, changes the way, or contributes to the individual differences of how the odors that you put out there. And you and George were doing this research.
Yes. And I'll give you one example of work that we published a few years ago. We were working with a company that provides fragrance that ultimately wind up in deodorant products or fine fragrances, things like that. So we decided to explore single fragrance materials rather than mixtures.
Mm.
Single compounds compounds and tried to determine whether any of those single compounds could reduce the impact of underarm odor collected from males, underarm odor collected from females. What we found when we tested both males and females for sensitivity to underarm odors, that about half of the compounds, and we had about 43 different compounds we were tested, about half of those compounds eliminated, or I shouldn't say eliminate, reduced, significantly reduced the impact of female body odor in the nose of males.
Okay.
Another handful of odors reduced the impact of the body odor of males in the nose of males.
Okay.
When we...
So it's gender-specific, different odorants. So you're talking about gender-specific differences and congruent or incongruent gender on the role of the decoder, right? So in other words...
To pile the point further was when we tested the female nose, the decoder is the female, none of the compounds significantly affected the impact of male body odor.
Oh, come on.
And only, I think it was 2 of the 43 or so significantly affected the impact of female body odor in the nose of women. So there's something particular to smelling social odors. Because we've never seen this dramatic gender difference in the decoder's nose when we use off-the-shelf odors. If something worked to reduce the impact of a particular off-the-shelf odor, if it worked in the men, it worked in women. But now when we switch to social odors, I'm calling them social odors because we get them from people.
Yeah.
And they're potentially providing information. For women, it seems that those social odors must play a very important role because it's really difficult to mask those odors.
So anecdotally, you know, people say women are more sensitive smellers than men, right? But this is almost playing into like what could fall into like an evolutionary narrative to why women would be more sensitive, especially to social odors, if we take into account like a parent-infant bonding, and you know, like this seems to fall into like a narrative that fits evolution very nicely. But it's interesting the way that you're saying it. Like nothing mediates women's ability to detect social odors. And I like the fact that you call them social odors because I think it's a blind spot in social communication or olfactory sense. You know, we're so visually and auditorily oriented that it's just not something people pay attention to. So how did you interpret the fact that women as decoders, nothing really affected their sensitivity, nothing mediated their ability to detect social odors?
Women have the potential for procreation at a much reduced level relative to men. Look at the history of Genghis Khan.
he was able to sow his seed freely.
Yes. So women have to be very selective to potential mates if they want to have a successful childbearing years. Now, there are many cues that women should or can rely upon. But it behooves women to pay attention to all cues. The sense of smell can be one of those.
So is this feeding into, since they're sensitive to social odors, them also being sensitive to which males are most genetically different, and the most genetically different from an evolutionary perspective would be a better partner because the goal of evolution, if one were to attribute one to evolution, is diversity. And the best way to increase diversity is to find a partner with as different a genetic, you know, makeup as possible.
That is
one was a loaded question, I know.
But. That's one interpretation, but it's a misinterpretation.
Okay.
It's not maximally different, it's optimally different.
Okay.
And there's research out of Scandinavia that shows that optimally different most likely is like fourth cousin removed,
okay.
Fourth, fifth cousin removed.
Mm-hmm.
Anything more divergent than that, fecundity decreases. Anything closer than that, fecundity decreases.
Interesting. So that's an interesting way of looking at it. So that when you say optimal, you mean there is like a genetic window of opportunity, a genetic distance that is best,
yes.
And getting too close obviously is going to cause some kind of genetic problems in the offspring, and getting too far is also going to cause problems maybe for different reasons.
We do know that the set of genes that regulate the immune system somehow are involved with mate selection,
okay.
Or may be involved with mate selection.
Okay.
We also know that differences in the genes that regulate the immune system also contribute to different body odors. The Scandinavian group that I just talked about did not look at the immune genes because they were working with lineages.
Mm-hmm.
And the lineages dated back to, I don't know, many generations.
Mm-hmm.
Before we even knew what the immune genes were. So they couldn't rely on genetics of the immune system for their interpretation.
So is that more just like an epidemiological, just kind of looking at genetic lineage research?
Yes.
Like were they able to bring it into the lab in any way?
No.
Okay.
It was all from public records.
Okay.
And what they were able to determine that was based on offspring and offspring who had offspring.
Mm-hmm.
That was how they defined degrees of fecundity.
Okay. And so this the reason why we got onto this topic is because the research you were doing with George about finding that females as decoders are more sensitive to social odors.
Yes.
Okay. And so you mentioned that the research that you did with George on this was relatively recent. So, you know, is that kind of the full arc of your research? You started with mice, you accidentally found out about the VNO, became an expert on that. That led you towards Monell and doing it on guinea pigs, and then as your involvement with Monell became more and more robust, going from assistant to associate to full member, you moved to humans, androstenone, specific anosmias, sensitivity to androstenone, and then working with George to kind of expand that research goal.
Yes, that's a good way to summarize it.
Well, and a question that I have, because we're going to be kicked out of here kind of soon, I think. I think there's a going to be a talk in a little bit. How do I want to ask this? So in the late 80s, early 90s, there was a lot of publicity about aromas that you could wear that had a human pheromone effect, right? So there was a marketing push for human pheromones. These are the kinds of things that you can find in the back of magazines, you
yes.
know, buy this Eros, or I don't even remember what the name.
Eros is one of them.
Okay. And you can put it on, and it had androstenone in it, and they were kind of riding on the coattails of research about human pheromones. And then, not and then, but in parallel to this, there's your research. There was research from a lab that was trying to say that the VNO is still a valid way for pheromones to be detected in humans. I think that you and George came to the conclusion that the VNO is not necessary for a pheromone reaction to occur. Dick Doty puts out a book called The Pheromone Myth, where he says that human pheromones, just it's a category error, if I can just put it in super blunt terms. So do you think that the research, the marketing of fragrances that had pheromones, human pheromone effects, was pushed by the research that you were doing? Or that the interest in your research was part of a zeitgeist of that, of the public being interested in human pheromones?
I think there were labs worldwide that pushed the whole concept from research that they published. George and I never pushed that idea.
Okay.
In fact, I think in one or more of our publications, we use the phrase caveat emptor, buyer beware, when thinking about the purchase of a human pheromone that may or may not contain androstenone. There are others that contain related steroid called androstenone. There are a few labs that pushed it to the extremes.
But of course, some of those labs, or at least the ones that I'm thinking of, that were pushing the VNO model, that research was being done by people that were also marketing a product.
Yes.
That they said was a human pheromone that worked on the VNO. So there's a little conflict of interest there. I'm not going to name names. But, it's gotten so silly. I remember reading something about there. They said, the impetus for this is attractiveness, making yourself more attractive. Like, so when that's put into the media, when that's put into the public, who doesn't want to be seen as more attractive, right? You know, who doesn't want to be able to attract the opposite sex or the same sex or whatever, you know, your sexual preferences? But it got so silly at one point that they were saying, well, it's not that this fragrance will cause somebody else to be attracted to you. It's that by you wearing it, your confidence level will be increased, and it is that confidence that'll attract the other person, which is just the most bending over backwards mental gymnastics way of marketing a product that is claimed to be a human pheromone. I mean, are you familiar with that?
I am.
I just want to make sure I'm not, I'm not misremembering it.
Nope.
All right, so. Well, Chuck, I'm going to have to end it there, like I said, because we're probably going to get kicked out of here soon enough. But I really appreciate your time.
And, most welcome.
And as always, I see you walking through the hall, and when you walk past the lab, you know, don't be afraid to say hi. And I look forward to more conversations like this off record.
Okay.
All right, thank you.